Lovey has a need in her body, battling with health, needs a miracle. Also another friend of Raina is in need of a touch from God in her body. Maria Brown, they found cancer, a mass in her brain. We're going to pray that God would touch her. Tracy Spears is battling pneumonia, needs a touch in her body. And Sister Madrid, I understand, was taken to ER before service. So we're going to pray for these needs. Grab somebody's hand, put a hand on their shoulder. Let's pray right now that God would minister. Meet these needs. God, in your name, I pray you touch Sister Madrid. You see whatever's going on in her body right now. We pray for Tracy, God, whatever that need is. I pray for Maria Brown that you would be with her in this time of need. We pray for Lovey and this other friend. God, that they are battling health. We know that you're the God that heals. Now we're turning our petition into praise. Somebody begin to thank God. The Lamb has overcome. Hallelujah, the Lamb has overcome. There's healing in this house today. There's deliverance in this house today. Oh, we sing hallelujah. The Lamb has overcome.
We sing hallelujah. 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 We sing
year they got in 20 hours. hours or so, and there are churches that are underwater, and many, many saints in a number of our churches have lost their homes completely, it looks like. And a number of those pastors were texting me today. In fact, I told them we would pray. So why don't we pray for the Houston area in this time? We want somebody praying for us if we just lost everything we had. God, I pray right now for the people in the Houston area. You are a God that sees and knows everything that we face. I pray that you would be with our brothers and sisters and all of the people and citizens of that community. Come be strong on their behalf and bring a spirit of unity to that community. Bring people together to help one another. We pray against the forces of evil that would loot and would take and would run even further. And we stand against the opposition forces of the devil that would try to destroy faith in this time. I pray that what the devil meant for evil, you're going to turn for good. Let blessing come to people in this time of need. Hallelujah, hallelujah. So our brothers and sisters, if you're watching tonight, we are praying with you. Amen. 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 There may be opportunity in the next few weeks where maybe some of you people that are in contracting or builders, or maybe you've got vacation days and you'd like to go help somebody in need, we'll try our best. This is something that is a growing thing, and Hope Corps alumni and different things are looking. We're looking at putting together a crisis team, emergency response team, and so maybe you got a few days you could give. As that develops, if you're interested in helping, if it's needed, you can call the office, and as those things develop, we will let you know. John chapter 3 and verse number 1. Amen. There was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, who was a ruler of the Jews. He came to Jesus by night and said to him, "Rabbi, we know that thou art a teacher. You are come from God, for no man can do these miracles that thou doest except God be with him." Jesus answered and said unto him, "Truthfully," or "verily," in the King James, "I say unto thee, except a man be born again," everybody say born again, "he cannot see the kingdom of God." Nicodemus saith unto him, "How can a man be born when he's old? Can he enter the second time into his mother's womb and be born?" Jesus answered, "Verily," or "truthfully, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God." So he says, unless you're born again, you can't see it. Then he goes further, as the questions go further, and he said, unless you're born, he gets more specific, of water and Spirit, you cannot enter the kingdom of God. And I want to use these verses of Scripture as the launching point for a few moments on this subject, the gospel in a world of pluralism. The gospel in a world of pluralism. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Amen. My thoughts tonight, honestly, probably developed over the last few weeks. As this church knows, the summer is a very busy time as we kind of zero in and focus on some of the things that we are a part of globally and even nationally. Summer is a season of camp meetings and conferences here in the United States, and God has anointed this church, a number of people, in fact, a large group of people helped lead the youth camp in Monterey, California. Then another number were leading camp meeting and family camp all the way in Alabama, and key people in this church. And then, as you know, the global training of Hope Corps, of which we have over 100 alumni in this church, are every year from Manhattan to the Philippines and Norway, and it's a growing thing. And so the summer gets full of what I would call global ministry because of the nature of the summer. And in the last 30 days, I have been in a number of countries. I have been in Honduras, I've been in Fiji, I have been in England, and I have been in Jamaica, and I have been this week in Norway, and I was there teaching. And you don't know what fun is until you haven't had sleep in 24 hours and then you have to preach. That's a lot of fun. There's no telling what you say when that happens. And it was an intensive week. Part of the reason was because three of the speakers had to cancel for different reasons, and so the teaching load kind of piled up, but it worked out for good. But my travels through the different places this summer, and then as summer comes to a close and your mind moves back into a more focus as we look at September, October, November, December, as we move to the year. And thankfully, we haven't experienced summer doldrums at the Rock. We have maintained revival, and that is a testimony of the maturity of this church and the leadership staff of this church and the men of God and women of God that have come in. And it's been a great summer. It's been a summer of revival at home as well as global impact. But honestly, as I have traversed the globe, I have noticed and recognized that faith in America, as far as our nation, to one degree is waning. And I have spent significant time in ministry in Europe, and I have watched as Western civilization is turning its back on faith in God. And we are living in an ever-increasing pluralistic society. And there is what sociologists call Christendom. I'm not talking about true Christianity. I'm talking that which goes by the label of Christianity. You have people that don't know God from Adam, but they were born in what is called a Christian family, and so they are either Christian in some parts of the world, or they are Islamic, or they may be Orthodox or Coptic or whatever it may be. It has nothing to do really with their own personal devotion. Simply has to do with the family or the community that they are born in. But here in what we would call Western civilization, this idea of Christendom is losing its place in our nation. And much of what we blame on issues in our society are honestly the result of faith being watered down. I sat this week with a pastor in Oslo, Norway. And all over Norway, one of the most beautiful countries you will ever see in your life, it is by far the cleanest place I have. You can almost eat on the streets. It is magnificently beautiful, clean, spectacular. I don't know how to describe how beautiful it is. And all over Norway, you will see beautiful and well-kept churches. But the sad thing is, those are simply well-kept church buildings, because very few people attend those churches. And in what is the most beautiful, one of the most beautiful places I have ever been, filled with beautiful church buildings, there is a burgeoning and growing rapidly Islamic community, not just of immigrants, but people that are becoming, even in Norway, followers of Islam. I sat in Grumman as I spoke with this pastor this week, and I asked him what is going on in Norway, and he said Islam is growing because they are the only people of faith that are willing to tell people what is right and what is wrong. And people are tired of living life without answers. And he said the Christian church in Norway for the last 50 years And now a new generation of young people are looking for somebody to declare what's right and wrong, and they know a dead, watered-down church world called Christendom is not providing answers. I'll tell you what that means to me. That means it's the day of the apostolic church. If somebody will get bolder than we've ever been, if somebody will get more in tune with the Holy Ghost, it's not a day to be intimidated. It's not a day to water down this message. It's not a day to look for acceptance. It's a day to stand up and declare the whole counsel of God. In case you're wondering, you're in a one God tongue talking holiness church. I'm not embarrassed. I'm not ashamed. It's the day of apostolic revival. Give somebody a high five and say it's our day. Let's have revival. Amen. You may be seated. Christendom is losing its grasp. Pluralism, maybe you studied it in your college class, but there's always been a sense of pluralism in every part of the world. There's a syncretism going on. There's pluralism. It's always been. But maybe what is new to our borders and the Western civilization is the sense, and this is going to make sense to some of you that are wrestling with some of these things on your campuses, or you're encountering Christians that are changing faith. What is going on in our society today? Man, I feel like preaching in the Holy Ghost today. Pluralism in the sense that plurality is approved and celebrated. It's not just that it's there as it's been historically, but now pluralism is now the approved way that you should think. And that it is celebrated, this idea of pluralism. Historically, what do I mean by that? Some of you that says, well, that sounds like big fancy terms of high learning. Well, let me just break it down a little bit. As they say, can I kick this for a minute? Let's just see where this goes. Historically, the Western world has been contrasted with the rest of the world because of what we would know as the Judeo-Christian ethic, coming from the Word of God, principles, doctrines, dogmas that were taught from the Word of God. And even when Western civilization had issues or problems, as time would go by, those that were hungering for truth would begin to speak truth to power. And that understanding that the more you read the Word of God, and the more you grow in the Word of God, the closer you get to God, that will begin to change behavior. And even though society had issues and problems and struggles and even some deep things that had to be worked out, given time, that Judeo-Christian, maybe it was a slow grinding process, but it moved into government, it moved into effect, it moved into communities, because there were what coming out of that were what became accepted public doctrines. Yeah, there was divisions theologically and different organizations and denominations, but there was an underlying thing that moved us in this realm of public doctrine. And it was shaped by Christianity at large because it provided the norm for conduct and belief. But here's what's happening. In case you're not paying attention, get off Instagram and Facebook and look around your world for a minute, and you're going to find out that our society is changing. And what have been long held understandings from Scripture are being challenged and changed and reworked. Pluralism is now thought to be a proper characteristic of a secular society. It's now thought to be proper. That Intellectuals have traded the Bible and have replaced it with nature. Where our forefathers established our ideas based on Scripture, and they looked at the Bible as the source. Intellectualism in America, in Europe today, and beyond, in the industrial world, is with our learning we are becoming mad. And we are looking now to nature to determine what is accurate and proper instead of Scripture. The Bible is becoming of minor importance to our Western society. And it is now made subject. Understand that 100 years ago, to stand up and speak ill of the old black book would have landed you in deep water. You could not have been elected to office and spoken negatively about the Bible. The Ten Commandments were in our schools. The Ten Commandments were in our courthouses. There was prayer in school. To have spoken against such would have caused deep problems for you as a leader. Now the Bible is of minor importance and is now subject to the scrutiny of reason. In fact, it is looked at through the eyes of criticism and textual criticism, looking for what are labeled inconsistencies. The internet has made it, provided a reservoir and a wealth of places to find issues with Holy Writ. It is now a book that is filled with absurdities. Even leaders of our nation have spoken in derogatory terms, speaking about what part of the Bible should I believe and what part should I not believe, because it's full of absurdities to the intellectual. It's full of tall stories that surely must not be taken literally. And in even college campuses, moving beyond that now the Bible is viewed by some as being full of immoralities. Because you're no longer looking at the book, you're looking at nature, and nature's study reveals that there's tall stories, and that would be an immoral thing. If you haven't encountered that, your children are. Your students are, because secular society and education is pushing us further and further away. If you want to look at what America will look like in 20 years, take a trip to Europe. We're headed there. This pluralism pushes primarily against what has been normative. Why do I say that? It pushes primarily against what has been normative, especially in the realm of faith. My personal opinion is that the reason is because pluralism springs or spawns out of rebellion. Go with me to the beginning of stories, the genesis of it all, and there you will find Lucifer in the garden. I'm preaching. I know it's kind of quiet, but I'm preaching. I hope you're listening today. Lucifer is in the garden. Instead of being the anointed cherub that covers now, he is a serpent trying to beguile Eve. And what does he do? He offers another view. He offers an alternative to the word and law of God that was established. It was an alternate reality. It was an alternate way. In fact, he gives her reasons why the established law was in place. He brings a deceptive twist. He provides for her. In fact, what he literally does is make the law that has been established by the word of God, he twists it in her mind, stating that the reason is because God has an ulterior motive, thus doing the same thing, basically saying the law of God is immoral. So pluralism, therefore, springs from that same idea. And here's what happens. It focuses primarily on what has been established, and it will open, I'll preach in a minute, I'm laying a foundation, I hope you stay with me. It will open the door to ideals and dogmas that are in fact far worse, just as long as its opposition to what has been established. I don't know if that makes sense to you. It would rather fight the established law of God or what has been viewed as the normal law of God and will embrace what is far worse than what it fights. Let me give you an example. Your college campus protest in the streets, in the media, gatherings. I'll use an example. In the last year or two, the National Basketball Association moved to change where its all-star game would be because of the stand on same-sex marriage and the whole transgender bathroom issue. Because North Carolina had laws in place, while more liberal or leaning issues in other states, because the All-Star game was scheduled there, they viewed it as a social issue of human rights. So they withdrew the All-Star game. Some of y'all are messing with your NBA God right now. But at the same time, pluralism raises its head. Because of human rights about a bathroom, they moved the All-Star game, while the same year they go to China to play basketball. You want to talk about real human rights? Ask some of the people that fled China because of forced abortion, because of death threats to their family. And pluralism doesn't pay attention to the grieving woman whose body has been affected and forced abortion upon her. They don't even look at that civil right. It's quiet. Or, as I sat in York, England, the week after Boston and Haley's wedding, I sat with John and Sherry Hemus as literally thousands of young people were screaming and chanting outside the restaurant where we were sitting, drinking tea in the afternoon, as they were waving flags of Islamic nations and protesting against what was going on in America. And they were waving flags and they were screaming about American decisions on same-sex marriage and transgender bathrooms while they were waving flags from nations that would kill you for being a homosexual. And I looked at the pluralism and I recognized people are being deceived, and more importantly than real rights and real decisions, they just want to rage against the machine. They want to rage against the law that's been established. Acceptance. It pulls. The way that pluralism affects the church is as the voices of pluralistic thought rise, we get so caught in the pull of acceptance. And churches get nervous about taking stands for anything because they don't want to be offensive to anybody. Brother Young, you get political correctness. No, I think you need to think before you speak. And we'd have a whole lot less issues if people would just shut their mouth and quit twittering as much as they did on both sides of the issue. When you come to the house of God, when it comes to the Word of God, there is no political correctness. It's plain and simple. It's right or it's wrong. It doesn't care if it offends you. It doesn't care if it offends me. When it comes to sin, when it comes to separation, when it comes to godliness or ungodliness, somebody better stand up and quit worrying about who they offend and who they got to get accepted by. When it comes to truth, you've got to declare the whole counsel of God. There is still right and there is still wrong, whether you like it or don't like it, or whether I agree or disagree.
Right.
Who qualifies you? Well, I'm glad you asked that. Go to your New Testament book of Acts. And that was one of the questions that they came to all of these people that were operating and taking stands and preaching. And they said, by what authority do you do all this? I like the New Testament church. You know what their qualification was? They just simply looked. They didn't go into a whole acceptance deal. They didn't try to write some political correctness to be accepted in the community. They looked back at all their detractors and haters, and they said, I'll tell you how we do this. We do this through the power of the name of Jesus. I have come to tell somebody, I've been buried in the name of Jesus. I've been filled with the Holy Ghost. He lives in me, and that's all the authority I need to take.
You're not going to somebody else that's got cancer.
it alone. Their message was repent and be converted. Now, we just throw repentance around like it's just a religious word. Let me tell you what. A real message of repentance and be converted is an opposing message to its hearers. Because to repent and be converted is to admit you're wrong. Why are we working so hard to make people feel comfortable? Have we forgotten what brought us salvation? It wasn't a cool hymn sermon. It wasn't some cool song. I tell you what got our tail out of that pew into an altar where we fell with tears running down our face. Somebody looked at us and said, you better get that sin out of your life. You're on your way to hell, and you better get your life right with God. I remember the night I fell in that altar. You say, well, that's a damnable damnation message. That's what I needed because I was on my way to hell. I didn't need anybody to give me cereal and pat me on the back. I needed a message that would change my life. Come on, Norway. You're looking for answers. The apostolic church has got it.
Be born of the water and of the spirit. If you don't have it, you can't see. this thing out. You can stand, run, jump, whatever. I'm just going to preach it. Through his word, God reveals his will and his purpose to humans. God has a will for every human being. And the way you find that is through the Logos and the Rhema. That's the written word in conjunction with the freshly preached word of God. Our human reasoning is summoned to understand and respond to the Rhema and the Logos. What I'm doing tonight is I'm pushing you and your spirit up against the wall. And the Spirit is pulling at you. And it's saying, what are you going to do with my gospel? You're either going to embrace it or you're going to reject it. There is no place for in between. There is no place for here, a little there. No. You're going to have to embrace it. You're either going to stumble or it's going to be your foundation. Church is the bearer of that gospel. Therefore, the church and its preaching calls into question all that governs, that rules, and influences. All that governs, all that rules, and all that influences. And if it does not measure up to the Logos, then the Rhema speaks to that power. You want to talk about real truth to power? It comes from the church. The church challenges government. The church challenges culture. The church challenges individuals. It challenges everything because this book is the pattern, not your family, not your friend, not your neighborhood, not your religion. This book challenges it all. And in judgment, every king, every president, every ruler will be judged by this book. Every preacher, every church member will be judged by this book. This is why, hear me, this is why the path or the road for social acceptance can never be the agenda of an apostolic church. Because the church, by its very nature, is to speak truth to power, truth to culture, truth to religion, and truth to society. It can never walk in agreement with culture. It can never walk in agreement with society. Society must walk with it. You may be seated or stand, whatever you want to do. I'm almost done. It challenges and confronts because, hear me. It challenges because Jesus said, I am. Anybody that comes any other way, he said, I'm the door. If anybody else comes in here any other way, he's a thief and a robber. That don't sound very pluralistic to me. And if you're going to come in like we used to sing, you've got to come in at the door. There is no pluralistic way into this thing. He said, I, everybody say Jesus.
Jesus.
He said, I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. Now, here's where it affects us. When we begin to get bold like this, don't just expect. This all feels real good on Sunday night when your brothers and sisters screaming beside you and you got the choir to get the Batman music going. But what happens, here's the rub, is that when you take a stand, there is going to be pushback. And you will be accused of being arrogant or even ignorant or dogmatic or outdated or old-fashioned. Can I just tell you something? Don't be afraid of those accusations. Why does that intimidate us so much? If we really believe you're going to hell without the Holy Ghost, then why would be intimidated? Would we be intimidated by anybody that told us different? You know what we need? We need a little radicalism. We need to get some talk of the hand spirit. I'm not talking about you, to your mama, but I'm talking. You know, I am sick of watching apostolic young people back up. Brother Young, every time you come in town from somewhere, you're a negative. No, this ain't a negative message. This is a message. If you get it, you're going to turn into a powerhouse. Where you're walking around with your big family Bible like the Pharisees stand on the corner saying, "Thank God I'm not like that." No, that's not what I'm talking about. But I'm talking about where you know that you know that you know. Where you have settled it, and in love you're looking at people and you're telling about God, and you're not intimidated, and you're getting up every day knowing that you're on your way to heaven and you want somebody else to go with you. Stop letting your friends back you in the corner. Get your head in the book. Get your knees bent in prayer. And get the Holy Ghost. And settle who you are. Establish who you are. And begin to tell the world what you've got. Let them say all they want to say. We've got to be faithful to the gospel that we declare. See, you got to make your life match, because you're the only thing standing between them and heaven. You can't hypocrite on Monday and then sing in the choir on Sunday. We have to spread this gospel, and our life has to match it. Spreading the gospel message requires understanding. I'm going to give you 3 points and I'll be done. If we're really going to get this gospel into this pluralistic society, there's 3 things that require clear understanding. Don't you never say you need clear understanding. This thing, number one, has to be free from coercion. By its very nature, the gospel is free. The price has already been paid on Calvary. It is the free gift of grace for whosoever will. Look at your neighbor and say, for all. What do I mean free from coercion? This, sorry to all of my dominion theology friends, this gospel doesn't work through political maneuvering. We are never going to bring Christianity through the election process of people to office. If you are hanging your hat on political candidates or political legislation, there is never going to be righteousness upon this nation. It will never happen, because evil men will wax worse and worse. It's going to be a seductive thing. I do not espouse dominion theology. I'm sorry, Hollywood will not get better. Politics will not get better. Society will not get better. This thing does not work through political coercion. You're never going to get enough to affect the ultimate thing and bring righteousness to a nation through politics. The only way we're going to have revival is the apostolic church. Get on fire. Get on fire. Thank you. people full of the Holy Ghost. Because people are fallen, they're earthy, they're broken, and all they got at best is broken solutions. That's why Jesus never carried a protest sign against abortion. I'm not against you if you do that, but you ain't going to change nothing. You're never going to convince that college student with your sign. You think standing in front of an abortion clinic, screaming at that young broken woman whose life is messed up and she don't have any answers and her family struck out on drugs and she wound up impregnated by some man that walked away, you think you're going to stand there with your sign and picture of a naked dead baby in a mother's womb and say you're an evil person and they're going to change? You know what they're going to do? They're just going to build more walls. You ain't never going to change society with a protest sign and an angry face. Look at everything that's going on. You ain't changing nothing. Let me just tell you, I'm going to follow up what I'm in the Holy Ghost right now. You better stop looking at society for answers because this thing's messed up. And what did Bishop say this morning? Hate. If you try to fix hate with hate, all you're going to wind up is being a hater. Let me tell you, this thing ain't getting better. Let me just tell you something. We can have a civil war in this country. The more you protest on either side of this thing, the more cars you run into people, and the more you shoot, and I'm telling you, you're gonna wake up the wrong people. And there ain't enough on either side to end it peacefully. And this nation could be ablaze in the next 10 years. You better not hang your hat on any of those causes, right or left, or any politician. What you better do is hit your knees and start praying like you never prayed before. The only hope for this nation is the apostolic church. You may not like that, but I'm your pastor, and you better hear it and understand the answer is only in Jesus Christ. Jesus didn't protest the Roman government. Jesus didn't protest. You know who he got ticked off at? He got ticked off at church people. You may be seated. Boy, I only preached 3 hours. I ain't even got it. This thing's got to be free from coercion. I'll tell you how you change the world. You want to change the world? Look at the master world changer. You know what he did? He got 12 disciples. 12 disciples. He didn't go get a convention hall. He didn't need 144,000. He didn't need a Bible school. He didn't need a university. You know what he did? He got 12 men and he poured himself into them. And those 12 men turned the world upside down. And before it was over, all of Asia heard the gospel in 2 years. This thing, number one, has got to be free from coercion. Number two, at the same time, we cannot domesticate the gospel. What do I mean by that? One of my favorite things to study is apologetics. Anybody like apologetics? That doesn't mean you go out and apologize to everybody. That means you know how to debate. Man, I have favorite apologists. We have a local one. He's got his degree in it. Oh, by the way, Carissa had a baby. Everything's healthy. Mama's doing good. I had a baby today. They're all celebrating. And there's a role for apologetics. I love it. I absolutely love it. I know Bishop loves it. My dad loves it. Awesome. I mean, these men, we love that kind of stuff. I love to listen to John Lennox. He's one of my favorite ones. No, I didn't say the Lennox from Egyptian Woman or whatever. John Lennox, he's an incredible apologist. I mean, he can debate. He's debated some of the biggest, and boy, they can talk about creationism and divine design. I mean, I love that kind of stuff. Let me tell you the benefit of having an Adam King in our church. that have given themselves to that kind of study. The benefit of an Adam King is that he empowers apostolic young people to learn why their faith, how their faith operates, and how things that make sense from Scripture. But here's the reality. You're never going to debate the gospel into somebody. It doesn't matter how smooth I get or how sharp I get in my argument. Mr. Hitchens, one of the premier atheists on planet Earth, who in the last few years died of cancer, debated with Mr. Turek and Mr. Lennox and some of the greatest minds of Christian apologetics, the Ravi Zachariases. I could go down a list of people that would blow your mind with their reasonable presentation and their doctrines that they put in logical thought. But never one time did Lennox or Turek convince Hitchens, because you cannot make it domesticated enough, because it's somewhere the gospel confronts and you have to bow your knee and say, I receive it by faith. I cannot make the gospel reasonable enough to you. I cannot give you all and make it plausible. I cannot make it smooth and easy. The kingdom of God is and forever will be a different world. I cannot make the world so comfortable for God to fit in it. He's too big to fit in that world. At some point, I've got to close my world down and step into His world. It's not about accepting Him. That's one of the biggest fallacies of Christianity. As if we're so important that we accept God, which is nowhere in Scripture. But He said, if you'll come out from among them and be separate, if you'll touch not the unclean, then I will accept you. See, the gospel's not about accepting Him into our busy, cultured, important Western civilization. That's where we went wrong. Trying to fit Him in between soccer practice and guitar lessons, French lessons in the afternoon, picking up the kids and then going to the soccer game, and then we'll give Jesus a little time on Sunday morning. Accept God into our world. When the reality is, Paul said, I count it all as dung, as waste, that I might win Christ. I want to be accepted by Him. You see, the gospel is always a different pattern for living. It's never going to be cool enough. High school students, college students, it's never going to be hip enough to be accepted at Consumers River. Sac State, it's never going to look at your apostolic distinctives and say, that makes sense. It doesn't matter how many coffee shops you put in the church. It doesn't matter how many good community outreaches we do and bring bus and feed children. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter how many social clubs we develop and parachurch ministries that affect. It doesn't matter how many kids we help in orphanages in Uganda and what. It doesn't matter. We're never going to make the church acceptable to a fallen society. We're never going to get endorsed by Fox News or CNN or the Hollywood crowd. They're never going to embrace the gospel, because the gospel demands a different pattern for living. You don't take my word, take His. He said, unless you're born again, you can't even see it. Which is the very reason you're never going to logically and reasonably convince your lost family why it's right and they're wrong. It's not going to happen. I'm helping you. Thanksgiving, you'll have a little time to prepare. Instead of going to Thanksgiving dinner this year to debate your unsaved family, what you ought to do is pray that the Holy Ghost is on you. Instead of planning your own argument how you're going to straighten the whole family out and you're going to reasonably, no. Instead of going looking for the debate, which is never going to work, why don't you just get so full of the Holy Ghost that they see something in you they've never seen? Sisters this morning. She was at a family reunion in Nashville, Tennessee this weekend. The whole family went in and they were at a restaurant and had, where the family gathered for the big dinner family, and boy, they were all together from all over America, and they're there. It's in a restaurant in Nashville, and they got the bar room right there, and it's open into the big dining area, and they're all there, and there was a hired band playing country western music. They sang 7 or 8 songs, and this sister and her husband were there at the family reunion. And they were drinking their Pepsi while everybody else was drinking their beer and wine. And it came and they said, the band hollered out, they said, "We're going to do one more song. And we want to take a request. What song does anybody want to sing?" And before the family could say anything, this sister in her church screamed out, she said, "Sing Amazing Grace." And the band leader looked down at her and said, "Man, that's been a long time, but maybe we can sing it." And he started singing, the band sang it, everybody started singing in the restaurant, and after it was done, she went up to him and he wanted to talk to her. He said, "Ma'am, are you holiness?" She said, "Yeah, I guess, whatever that means, yeah, I am." He said, "I knew when you walked in this restaurant tonight where you were." He said, "While I was singing that song," he said, "it was everything I could do to quit from crying, because," he said, "I was raised in one of those churches." He said, "Here's my Facebook. Would you help me find one of those churches in this town? Somewhere you gotta get bold. You gotta step out in faith." My God, how many more people are desperately looking for an answer? Instead of coercing, why don't we just be the church? Hallelujah. Amen. Musicians, would you come? We're never going to be able to explain miracles. It just happened. We're never going to be able to explain the supernatural. There are dimensions that are beyond. There are places where the laws of physics do not apply. Anybody ever had a miracle you know is a miracle? Let me see it here. Luke, you ever seen the lame healed? Did you come up here? Just all these doubters. That's not a preacher. That's a young man. He was in Los Angeles. Were you there? And you saw a man completely healed out of a wheelchair. You saw it with your own eyes. Not something I told you or somebody. You were there. Let me tell you something. That don't make sense. CNN ain't going to believe that. John Allen, run up here. Fox News ain't gonna believe this. The news media lied. Imagine that. You ever seen anybody raised from the dead? Oh, wait. You have seen somebody raised from the dead. They had been in the water dead for 30 minutes. He pulled the dead body out of the water. Him and Danny. Am I telling the truth? Am I making this up? We didn't have this plan like some Holy Ghost convention at a conference center somewhere. You pulled a dead body out of the river. And you put it in your boat and you drove back to the dock 10 minutes down. He was dead the whole time. She, that's right, yeah, she. And they began to pray. And while they were praying for a dead woman on the concrete boat ramp, the dead body started coughing. The news media said they did CPR. Did your lips ever touch that woman's lips? You'd have needed CPR if they would have, because Kim would have killed you. I'm telling you, folks, what we got ain't the same world we live in. Third one. I'll be back Tuesday night. get to number three at some other point. Let me just tell you something. If we want to have a revival in Sacramento, we got to get crazy again. We got to get bold again.
Right.
We got to be those crazy one God Pentecostals. That aren't intimidated about one cotton picking thing. I feel a redneck.
Thank you.
that. Go to sleep. When you wake up, start shouting. Daddy, what's mama doing? She's going crazy for Jesus. Ah! Look at shout, son. But that ain't what bugs me the most about young married couples. The husbands kind of tick me off sometimes. Y'all getting evangelist Sunday, the pastor showed up. This is what ticks me off. Is this time to worship? And you act like you're the first guy that ever worked a job. You're too tired to lift your hand. You don't have energy to worship God, but you got enough cynicism to go fellowship the whole time we're down here praying with people. Man, I feel like Rick Mayo right now. I watch some of you. We're down here praying for other people. I mean, we got people down here praying that all they've only known God 6 months, but they didn't want to help somebody. And you're back in the back door. Until the preacher just kind of glances and you go. The bishop kind of does that long. And you go. You wouldn't have made it in the old days where you had to work in the field, get up at 5 in the morning, work till 3 o'clock, come get some dinner, and go to church 7 nights a week for a Bible. Brother Young, I'm tired. So? Nobody else in this church is tired? Nobody else works a job? Nobody else ever had kids? Boy, I didn't want to meddle.
Good preaching.
Sean, come out here. How many kids you got? 4? How old's the oldest one? How old's the youngest one? 10. 18? 10. And you're married to Matt, the absent-minded professor. Matt, you got a good woman. You better keep it. You know what I've seen Tashana do? I've seen Tashana never miss choir practice. Never miss praise team practice. Sing every time we ask her to sing. I've seen her carry boards up those stairs. I think she's got a workout plan here in drama or something. I don't know how she's doing that. Now, I'm going to offend some of y'all because I didn't choose you. Don't give me, you got 4 kids. She's got 4 kids too. Thank you. You can step back. Nanny, I guess you quit going to church when you had 2 girls. Boy, you had to sit on the platform. What'd you do with them 2 kids? No, I married one of them. I know that ain't true. Hey, we're talking about real commitment. In LaGrange, Georgia, on January the 17th in 1968, my dad got up to preach. My mama got off the organ, and a lady stepped in the back and said, "Pastor, you can't preach tonight." He said, "Bless God, why can't I?" She said, "Your wife just went to the hospital to have her baby." And I was born that night. My mama got off the organ the night I was born. Don't tell me I can't do it. What I'm saying is we got to go back to Pentecost. We got to go back to just being crazy about Jesus. We got to figure out.